Hi. Welcome to Introduction to Philosophy. You're going to have to bear with me. I've got a bit of a cold. This is one of the bonuses of an online class. I don't get you sick unless it's a computer virus. Anyhow, that wasn't a very good joke. We're not off to a good start here. Anyhow, this is Introduction to Philosophy, Phil 101. This video is for Section 7 and 8, CRN 13760 and 12558, respectively. Winter 2016, Oakland University College of Arts and Sciences, Department of Philosophy. Online class. This video is designed to get you through the syllabus and to explain the general policies and how the course will unfold. So this is probably the most important video. I don't know about that. Maybe the content videos might be more important than this one. But nonetheless, this one will tell you what we're going to do and where your grades come from and the policies and the structure of the course. So it's important to actually pay attention and go through this video fairly carefully. I've printed a copy of the syllabus. You can print a copy or pull up a copy, and you can follow through as we go through this syllabus. So it's an online course. That means we're not coming into campus to do tests or anything along those lines, which is good for me. I'm in Canada right now. Not right now. I live in Canada. I'm a commuter. I've been teaching at Oakland University for since January 2015, so that's some sort of a landmark. January 2016 now. 2005, sorry, is when I started. So, long bloody time. My email is there. That'll be your primary sort of contact for me. My office hours, we have a new building. We're over in the engineering building yet. I've not actually set foot in my office that I share with a number of other people. But I'm assured I have one, and it is MSC 642. I'm doing these office hours by appointment, and actually pointing out that for the most part, I think we can do office hours virtually via Skype. I'd be happy to meet with you that way. If you absolutely want to meet with me face to face, that's fine. And of course, I'm happy to meet with you face to face as well. Just give me a bit of advance notice because I'm not into campus that often this semester. This course meets virtually, and you're best to contact me as problems arise rather than at the end of the semester talking about problems that have happened throughout the semester. That way, we can help you before things get too far derailed and get you back on track with the class. So, this course, I'm just talking about the course catalog description and gen ed right now, is supposed to introduce you to the main types and problems in Western philosophy, and we'll do that. It's supposed to be, the readings are supposed to be chosen to illustrate the development of Western thought from the ancient Greeks to the present. We'll do that. It's a historical introduction, and it satisfies your gen ed requirement for Western civilization knowledge exploration. So, effectively, the learning objectives with regard to the gen ed have to do with learning to use language to engage with, communicate, and criticize ideas. What this has to do with in terms of practicality for this semester is you writing a whole lot and developing your skills in using language in a very precise way to describe ideas, to engage with concepts, to criticize, to largely communicate your understanding. Right, so we'll be doing a lot of that. You'll see the term tests and the writing project are all designed to help you become better at communicating about these ideas. Even the discussion forums are a little bit more conversational, but nonetheless, you're to actually communicate a clear understanding or at least questions about the material clearly. So that is what we will be doing this semester. There are a lot of textbooks for this course. It's often I have students that are completely freaked out by the number of textbooks for this course. I labor to keep them really, really cheap. It's basically I do this because I prefer if we're going to talk about Socrates to go to the writings about Socrates rather than say one of these here publications, or what's another example, something like this, right? So if I pick something like this, what you'd be doing is paying $130 for it, and what you would get as a result of it is this John guy's interpretation of these materials rather than straight from the horse's mouth and you being invited to engage with these materials. So, I mean, you're getting a university education. The name of the game is to have the ability to engage with these materials. So, guess what? I order these materials for you. We're starting with Plato's Five Dialogues. Don't get confused right off the bat because it says Plato here and I'm calling it Socrates. These are early, early works, and specifically the Apology and the Crito are thought to be explorations of Plato's mentor's position, Socrates. Right? So I call this Socrates. Not all of this Socrates, but these two dialogues, I consider these to be Socrates' position. The Apology, or his trial defense, and the Crito, a dialogue he had in prison awaiting execution. Anyhow, this set of readings is going to be themed around the idea of justice within democracy. You see, what I do is I try to theme the readings so that they address ideas or concepts or issues that you might find interesting. And you guys are up in sort of election time, so the concept of justice and what a democracy is might be sort of interesting to you, as it is to me. We both live in modern Western democracies that to some extent have a legacy of rights and responsibilities that follow from the ancient Athenian democracy that Socrates was engaging. So hopefully that'll be interesting. From Socrates, we move to Plato. This is less confusing because it says Plato. It is Plato. And then it says Phaedrus, who's a character in this particular dialogue. The Phaedrus is one of the two love dialogues from Plato's work, the other being the Symposium, which in a lot of ways, I don't know why I don't teach the Symposium, but it would be an interesting one. It's more fun. The Symposium is designed around a drinking party kind of thing, though this one's a little bit more straightforward and one place in which we get Plato's metaphysics, epistemology, and ethics all in the one location. Don't worry, I'll unpack those terms in the next video. So the Phaedrus is, like I say, a love dialogue. You know, to some extent, most of us have some sort of interest in the idea of love, and we've all heard the term platonic love. Well, it comes from Plato. Let's see what Plato has to say about platonic love. Right. So anyhow, we're not going through the entire thing. We're going through about half. I have you stop at page 49. Whoop, too far. Right there. Right. So that will be the second of the readings. And like I say, I concentrate on Hackett translations of these, which are old but good translations that keep the books dirt cheap. Right. After that, we'll have a section test. Right. And following that section test, we will move on to Aristotle and his Nicomachean Ethics. Name of the game here is Happiness. It's a longer book. There are 10 books to this particular publication. We'll be taking a look at books 1, 2, and 3 on how to live a good life, or happiness, as the layman would call it. Right? So that's the name of the game with Aristotle. You might want to be happy. Aristotle's going to give you sort of a football strategy for how to actually desire the sorts of things that you desire in a way that's likely to bring about happiness. Right? Then, we shift gears completely. There's a period in philosophy called the medieval period. We have to pick and choose with the course this length, and with a historical period 2.5 millennia long. I've chosen to jump over the medieval period, even though there's lots and lots of really, really interesting stuff that goes on within this period. We are jumping past the medievals to the early moderns, and specifically Thomas Hobbes. At the midpoint of the course, we've talked about justice, we've talked about love, we've talked about happiness. I call that the puppy dogs and ice cream stage. Then we talk about political power in Hobbes' Leviathan. This is probably one of the most important works of political theory ever produced. It's still sort of a going concern at conferences. It's printed in English, right? It's written in English. This is not a translation, but it is old English. And you'll have to sort of phonetically work your way through it. It sounds scarier than it is when I first sat down and read through this work. I was taken aback by the language initially myself, but by about my second chapter in, I kind of got used to it. Right? So part of what we have to do if we're going to engage with sort of a Western civilization exploration area is get used to engaging with works that some extent might make us uncomfortable, with some works that we'll find challenging. Right, so I've got a series of videos for all of this, but specifically this, that will help you tease out the important ideas and frame sort of an understanding of the political position taken by Hobbes, which, it is intuitively a position that we would like to criticize. The more you look into Hobbes' argument, the harder it becomes to criticize. Sort of a funny thing goes on there. So that's Thomas Hobbes. So that's our brief sojourn in early modern philosophy. Then we jump over to one, the most expensive book that I've asked you to purchase, and two, probably the densest passage of philosophy that you'll come across. Guy by the name of Soren Kierkegaard, he has more pseudonyms than I have pairs of socks. Generally, he picks up a new pseudonym every time he explores a new position. So when he's arguing this way, he's Jonas Climacus. When he's arguing this way and being a staunch ethicist, he's Judge William. Anyhow. Kierkegaard, religious existentialist, sort of one of the fathers of existentialism, sort of proto-existentialist, sort of a proto-postmodernist as well. The name of the game with Kierkegaard, we're taking a look at Sickness Unto Death, very short section starting at page 350 of this text, and I think it's 372. We end at, right? So I make you buy the entire book just for that. I make you buy the entire book because before this semester, I'm not sure what I'm going to have you read of this. And when it comes to Kierkegaard, I like to jump around a little bit to illustrate more general position. So best to have the anthology. It's the best translation that's out there. I was going to tell you what the theme is here, despair. So the puppy dogs and ice cream phase is over when we turn to Kierkegaard's Sickness Unto Death. Despair is a sickness unto death, right? So that's what it is. Anyhow, we'll turn to Kierkegaard towards the end of the semester, and we will conclude the semester with probably the most widely circulated volume of Nietzsche. This is the portable Nietzsche. Your cover may not look like this. You may just have the funny picture of Mustache Man. But nonetheless, it should be, I think, anybody's first introduction to Nietzsche. The book's designed that way. We will be taking a look at a section of this called Twilight of the Idols. towards the end. Idols are values, and Nietzsche tends to think they're in a state of twilight, or they're starting to wane. So this particular work from Nietzsche has the rather modest task of engaging with a radical revaluation of all value. Right, so he's going to basically turn Western philosophy on its head here. So, like I say, these books, I've labored to keep them fairly cheap. You can probably see if I go up close here and don't block my light source that I paid $5 for this copy, my new copy, used. My original copy here, held together by packing tape, has the other cover on it with the big mustache guy. It's actually newer, but nonetheless, I paid some sort of paltry sum for this used as well. There should be cheap books out there for you. I've been using these same textbooks for a long period of time, so there should be lots used. Then I understand that you can rent them as well. So you got that going for you. All right, so those are the books. Why did I order so many books? Well, because I like to get you straight from the horse's mouth rather than the expensive sort of Joe Schmo's interpretation of philosophy the other way, right? So that's what I'm doing there. Plus, this is cheaper. It's generally. So, anyhow, that's good for you. I wrote a course description. I'm going to leave that to you. What I am going to say is I try to theme this course around three general notions. The idea of a human nature condition, the relationship between reason and desire, and debates surrounding the underlying nature of truth. Right? Those are the big three ideas that I try to engage with, largely because I find students find them interesting. So, how do I grade you? There are going to be three tests this semester. I've altered this slightly. I bowed in previous semesters to student requests for more frequent and shorter tests. Then what I found is that they would miss the shorter and more frequent tests, lowering their grade. I don't want to lower anybody's grade, so what I've got are, rather than six section quizzes, what we have are three section tests this semester. So you've just found, I've introduced you to the six theorists that we'll be studying this semester. Two of them on each test. The test won't be comprehensive. It'll probably be five shorter answer questions and one longer, probably comparative question. That's the way it'll go for that. 20% of your final grade each for those tests, totaling 60% of your final grade. Each of these theorists is going to be accompanied by a discussion forum. I'll post a question or get the ball in the discussion rolling, and then you will engage in an ongoing conversation about these theorists with the rest of the people in the class. All right, so that's hopefully what will happen there. Since we're a virtual class, this is the only way we get class participation in this format. So this is how you participate. That's worth 15% of your final grade. Every semester, I have some students who just forget to do that section and are quite surprised when their grade is poor at the end of the semester. Where did all my grades go? Well, you didn't do the discussion forum. So you're best to keep up with those. Funny thing I do with the discussion forums is I leave them open, all of them, all semester. So in January, your first one at Socrates will come up. When does that close? April 25th. All right. So your second one goes up towards the end of January. And when does that close? April 25th. All right. So you've got all semester with these. So that's a portion of your grade that you are completely in control of right up until the final bell tolls. So that's what's going on with those. I'll say more about those in a minute. The final writing project proposal form. It's I grade that pass or fail. The idea is to give me a substantial plan for the writing project in advance of the writing project. And I ask myself basically one question: did you do it or didn't you do it? With that, that's worth 5% of your final grade. So essentially, that's 20% of your final grade in terms of forms. And all you really have to do is show up and engage with these forums. This isn't a point where you have to be perfect or correct. You can ask questions in these forums, that sort of thing. So it's essentially free grades that I'm giving you for just doing stuff, right? Which is, I'd say, pretty good. The writing project proposal forum closes on the last day of classes. I've got the date further into the syllabus there. That way, I know you've done it before the due date of your final paper. So that way you've got something down on paper before you sit down to write your final paper as well. Plus, I get to compile a lot of grades beforehand. Right, so that's good. And then there's a final writing project, which I'll say more about, which is worth 20% of your final grade. So that's how your grade breaks down. Note also that you'll get a grade out of 20 on each of your quizzes and on your final writing project, that sort of thing. So at any point this semester, you should be able to do simple math to see how many points towards 100 you've got. So 20% is 20 points and the course just totals 200. So should be relatively straightforward there. Now, course policies, under the page 2 general policy section here. I got to start off by saying I don't think you're bad people. This is the accusatory point in this video, but I'm not accusing you of anything. These are just here because I've had problems in the past, and a lot of problems in the past. So now I have policies to handle each of these problems that I've had in the past. It's best if we're all on the same page ahead of time. That way you know what the policy for plagiarism or missed assignments or assignment submission or email or discussion forum content or extra credit. You know the answer to these questions even before you have to ask these questions. And if anything comes up later in the semester, like I missed an assignment, well, here's a policy to refer to, right? I'm a big believer in solving problems before they become problems. So, plagiarism. Effectively, don't do it. I'm a tough cop, right? But it's what I've done is I've quoted, and I'll read the official Oakland University policy on plagiarism. They've recently moved it around, so I had to give a new reference. But notice when I quote, I reference. There's a footnote there. So, it reads, what is plagiarism, Professor Yoakum? Well, plagiarism, plagiarizing the work of others. Plagiarism is using someone else's work or ideas without giving that person credit. By doing this, a student is, in effect, claiming credit for someone else's thinking. Whether the student has read or heard the information used, the student must document the source of the information. When dealing with written sources, a clear distinction should be made between quotations, which reproduce the information from the source word for word within quotation marks, and paraphrases, which digest the source of the information and produce it in the student's own words. Both direct quotations and paraphrases must be documented. Even if a student rephrases, condenses, or selects from another person's work, the ideas are still the other person's, and failure to give credit constitutes misrepresentation of the student's actual work and plagiarism of another's ideas. Buying a paper or using information from the World Wide Web or Internet, love the redundancy there, without attribution and handing it in as one's own work is plagiarism. So that's what it is. That said, Oakland University has a big library. We wouldn't have a big library if we didn't want you to go and see what was written there and benefit from the interpretations and theories of other people. We should benefit from the work that's come before us. I mean, look around. This is an office that has lots of books in it. I'm just moving in. Lots of my books are still in boxes. Right? So I obviously use other people's ideas all the time. What's a good example? Here's one right here. I'm reading a book on Heidegger and ethics. I'm going to use Dr. Hodges' interpretation of Heidegger and ethics, even though so far from what I read, I think she's wrong. All right? Well, how will I do that? I will say, Hodge argues, blah, 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 in my own words, interpreting her argument, then there will be a footnote that will read Joanna Hodge, Heidegger and Ethics, Rutledge, whatever the date is, etc., etc., etc. Right? See pages this to this. So, if I'm using this, and it's perfectly fair, and in fact it's good academic work, to use something like this, I say that I'm using it, and I'm interpreting it. I'm still getting credit for interpreting it, but I'm using somebody else's ideas. I'm not just claiming her ideas as my own. Another example. Here's another theorist I turn to sometimes. Canadian theorist by the name of Mark Kingwell. Kingwell argues blah, 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 blah. Right? Kingwell argues. I get credit for interpreting Kingwell. Kingwell gets credit for having the bloody idea in the first place. Everybody's happy. That's good academic work. Right? Now, if I just grabbed what Kingwell argues there, either word for word, or just the ideas, and claim that they're my own, what am I? I'm effectively a thief. Right? So, plagiarism is pretty well the cardinal academic sin. I'm a tough cop on it. Oakland University has a strong policy on it. I've had a number of cases through the Dean of Students Office, and the sanctions can be quite severe. My policy in the course is zero tolerance. If you plagiarize, you fail. So don't do it. You don't just fail the assignment, you fail the course. So don't do it. It doesn't do some cost-benefit analysis. It doesn't make sense. All you need is a footnote. All you need is to say, hey, I read this cool series of ideas over here, and so-and-so argues, etc., etc., and that helps me understand this material that we're engaging with here. Right? That's just fine and dandy. Right? Now, that said, in this course, this is an introduction to philosophy course. I am way more interested in what you understand of this material than what somebody else understands, than what Joe Schmo over there understands, or what the Idiot's Guide to Understanding Philosophy understands of this material, or what SparkNotes or Wikipedia. Wikipedia is an awful source. It's just awful. All right? I can tell you I'm an editor on Wikipedia. Students of mine have plagiarized me, right? So just don't do it. We won't have any problems. Rest of my policy. Zero tolerance. Any student suspected of this form of theft will be automatically passed on to an academic review board. That's through the Dean of Students Office, and it's just what my contract says I have to do. Oh, this is plagiarized. I have to pass. I'm contractually obligated to do that. Then they look into it, they find the sources, and then we all wind up in a hearing, right? That's no fun. No fun for anyone. Lots of tears, that sort of thing. Expulsion from the university is possible. And course policy for this event is automatic failure. Now, I have another footnote. That footnote directs you to Oakland University's site rate program through the library, right? And through the Academic Writing Center. It's a very, very good online tutorial on how to reference. I've done it. I learned things, right? So if you're unsure how to properly cite, I'll say a few words about it myself, but if you're unsure how to properly cite, this is where you turn to on campus for the help you need to learn how to obey the rules pertaining to this, right? So, yeah, please avail yourself to the CiteWrite program through the Academic Writing Center, and there's a link to it. Go through the tutorial, it doesn't take too long. All right. So, plagiarism, finger wag, finger wag, finger wag, don't do it. Right? I know you haven't done anything yet, I don't even know you yet, and I'm already pointing a finger at you. That's no fun. Right? I expect we won't have any problems with this. I expect to have a lovely semester and to explore some brilliant ideas with you. This is just here because I've had problems in the past. I'm actually waving a finger in reverse. Right? In order to solve a problem going forward. Right? Missed assignments. I, of all people, understand that life happens. I've recently become father to twin girls, one of whom has some pretty severe health problems. So I understand that sometimes just life happens, the sky falls, right? So I'm very willing to work with you, provided you're very willing to work with me. So I have a policy, and this policy is designed to have a student to prevent a student from emailing me in April about an assignment that they missed in February, because that's too long. You'll see with the assignments, I post an answer key. It helps me with my grading. It gives you a frame of reference. It creates a document that we can discuss with regard to your document. Right? So that's what I do. And as soon as that goes up, it's too late, you can't write the assignment because I already told you what the right answers on the assignment are, right? So, or how I'm assessing. This is the secret assessment key, right? It's just too late. So, I've got a missed assignment policy. In the unfortunate event that you miss an assignment due to serious illness or a death in the family, these things happen, or some sort of other family emergency, I'm fully willing to work with you. You must notify me via email or by a message with the departmental office, either before the date or time in question. If you're sick and not going to be able to get it done, just tell me, all right? Or if something's happened and you are not going to be able to get your work done on time, just tell me, or within 12 hours of the deadline or due date, all right? So by like the next day, 12 hours, right? That's a lot of time. Oh, whoops, I missed the assignment deadline due to, you know, my car breaking down and me being stuck on the side of the road for 7.5 hours or something like that, right? So that's, I get it. These things happen, and I'm more than willing to work with you here. You just have to work with me. Extensions require a conversation. I'm willing to have that conversation with you. You just have to have that conversation with me around within 12 hours of the deadline, and I'll work with you. We can work it out. But 3 months later, that's a big problem. 3 weeks later, that's also a big problem. By then, I've already graded the assignment and handed it back. All right? And what's more, Moodle being the way that it is, I don't start grading assignments until the extensions have elapsed. Why? Because it generates feedback for the students who have submitted. You know? So, here, the right answer is already out there in some sense, right? So, anyhow, missed assignments. Try not to miss assignments. Try to be timely with everything. If life happens, I'm willing to work with you. And in that event, we can have a conversation, provided you have the timely conversation with me about it. All right? That's all. That's all. And I think that's pretty fair. Assignment submission. Here's the thing. There are a lot of you, and we're submitting our assignments to Moodle. Make sure that your assignment has been submitted to Moodle properly. Make sure you've got the right document and that it is uploaded to Moodle, right? Once you submit it, that's your submission. So make sure you submit properly. That's all. right? You can log on and double check that your submission. If you're unsure about it, email it to me in addition to submitting it to Moodle. First place I look is Moodle. So, assignment submission. That it's your responsibility to ensure that your assignments have been properly uploaded to Moodle. When you submit your assignment, be sure to double check that that your upload was successful. If I do not have it, it's not there. Right? So, you know, it's I think pretty fair as well. Right? Then email. Couple of things about email. I'm teaching 3 online classes. That means I've got a lot of online students that are going to be relying completely on email in order to get me their assignments and in order to communicate about any course issue, about course content, etc., etc. In addition to that, I communicate with my department. I have professional contacts through email. And effectively, in the height of the busy time in the semester, I would have to be working 28 hours a day just to keep up with all of my emails, giving everybody a personal response. There aren't 28 hours in a day. There's just no way to keep up with this, right? So I do, from time to time, fall behind on emails. A couple of things with that. Don't expect an immediate response. I'm going to try to be as timely as possible, but if you've waited 3 hours for a response and I haven't responded again yet, don't send me another email, because that just jams up my email inbox even further. Right? It's just give me time to properly read, properly think about, properly consider, and properly respond to your email. Second thing, if I have maybe like 10 questions that are all the same from students, I email everybody a response. I'm not ignoring you. I'm just trying to be efficient with this, right? To give you each an individual response would take 10 times longer than sending everybody a response to that question, right? I figure if 10 of you email with me with a question, then everybody probably has that question, or 2/3 of you or something along those lines. So I'm just trying to be efficient that way. Let me see. Last thing is, Oakland University likes to have the Oakland University logo on things. They require that all course correspondence should happen through an official Oakland University email. Don't go online and find one of my other email addresses. I won't respond to you from there. And technically, I'm not supposed to respond to email that comes from a non-Oakland University email address, though I usually respond to your question and then send you a reminder about that. So anyhow, get that Oakland University account up and running, and that should be the way that I'm getting emails from you. That's the way I'll respond. So anyhow, email, discussion forum content policy. First off, keep it classy, right? It's, we're talking about things like issues that might get you hot under the collar, right? We're talking about justice. We're talking about love. We're talking about happiness. We're talking about despair. We're talking about values. We're trying to, philosophers talk about all of those things that you're not supposed to talk about, polite conversation. It's just what we do. That's the way it is. We talk about those things. We're nosy. We stick our noses into all of these. So you're likely to hit issues that have some sort of a powerful emotive effect on you. If you are arguing in the discussion forums, make sure that your arguments are addressing and aimed at and being critical of the positions argued and not at the arguer in terms of a derogatory. So any sort of inflammatory, that sort of thing, I've got a zero tolerance policy on personal attacks, right? And any posts of that nature, I read them all, will be removed, and some sort of penalty will be assessed to the student, to the offending student, right? So keep it classy. Number two, with the discussion, it should be topical. The Plato Forum is for discussing Plato, right? It's not for, hey, can I have somebody's notes on? It's not for, hey, did we get our grades back for how did everybody do on that test? Hey, I think I'm going to go kayaking this weekend. Anybody want to come? That's not what it's for. The Plato Forum is for discussing Plato. The Socrates Forum is for et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So keep it on talk, right? So that's all I ask with the discussion forums, right? It's an instructional resource and should only be treated like an instructional resource, right? And extra credit, before anybody asks, no, there's no extra credit. What I do rather than extra credit is give you complete control of a lot of your grade right up until the last minute of the course, right? I'll show you how this works with when we turn to the schedule. I mean, if we're just taking a quick look at this, the discussion forums are open until April 25th at 11:55 p.m., 5 minutes to midnight. That's 15% of your final grade. Your final paper doesn't come in until exactly the same time, April 25th, 11:55 p.m. So that's where 20% of your final grade. So that's 35% of your final grade that's right there in your hand until the end of the course. That's a substantial chunk. Another 5%, which is essentially free sort of planning time sort of grade for you for the discussion forum, right? That's 40%. And very late in the semester, we have the third quiz third test coming in, right? So that's effectively what we're looking at there, right? So you have a lot of control over your grade right up until the end. Extra credit is extra, and unless I offer it to everybody, in which case it's not extra, right, it just doesn't pan out. So, evaluation, discussion forums. You'll see the way these get going. The idea here is that we'll discuss, first off, Socrates, the Apology and the Crito. I might ask you something about his moral position. I might ask you something about his account of human nature. I might ask you something about the Socratic daemon, et cetera, et cetera. You'll understand what this is by the time you read the book and by the time you screen the videos, right? I might ask you something about the additional video content, right? Something from Alain de Botton or Rick Roderick or something along those lines. And that'll get the ball rolling for a discussion about Socrates in that discussion forum. Now, if you're completely confused by something that Socrates has written, perfect place to ask a question of the rest of the class is on the discussion forum. Okay, this may not address the question that Professor Yoakum put up, but I'm a little bit confused. I'm wondering if somebody could explain to me why Socrates argues that we shouldn't fear death, or something along those lines. Perfectly acceptable to ask that kind of a question. So effectively, the discussion forums are your rough workspace to develop an understanding about this material. Right? And when I turn to grade these, I just want to see that you are effectively using these resources and putting a concerted effort into using these resources and generating a conversation. Replies to other people's posts get you credit in here, right? Posts of your own get you credit in here. Asking questions get you credit in here. Responding in some sort of long thought out paragraph form get you credit in here. You know what? If you like, record a video, post it to YouTube, and throw a link up there where you discuss the discussion forum. That's another way to get credit there. Turn it into an art project. Create a Socrates song. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Engage with the resource. So, posts like, I agree, or this is stupid, without additional comments, those are going to get you a low grade. If you miss a discussion forum, that's going to negatively affect your grade. If you do the bare minimum, like one short post for each of them, really, that's probably about a C. You've done the minimum to pass, and you're going to get the grades that are minimal to pass, right? So what I want to see is a substantial sort of engagement with this resource, right? And get a conversation going. You don't have to be right. All you have to do is be trying. This is these are your grades for try. Right. So I asked myself three questions when I assigned the grades for the forums. Have you posted like at least once for each topic? More is better. The idea here is to foster an ongoing conversation about the ideas and issues raised by the material at hand. Right. At least once. That's minimal. That's to get you a pass. More is better. Two. Are the posts substantial? Do they the posts offered show engagement with the material? I can tell if you're engaged with the material or not. Right? So, is it on topic? Have you tried to understand the material as you're engaging with this resource? Right? That's the second question that I ask myself. And then finally, are the posts timely? I understand people trying to bump up their grade by hit the discussion forum a couple of days before the finals come in, right? I get that. That's going to happen, right? And I'm willing to give it credit. But what I would prefer to see and where the better marks come from is substantial engagement throughout the course with this course resource, right? I leave it open right until the end of the course because guess what? The first substantial section of Nietzsche's Twilight of the Idols that we'll be taking a look at is called The Problem of Socrates. Right? Interestingly, Aristotle tries to ground ethics by referring to a determinate concept of happiness. Hobbes claims he can't do that. These two are in dialogue with one another. Right? Aristotle was the student of Plato. Plato was mentored by Socrates. Kierkegaard refers to Socrates and the Socratic concept of sin and an idea about human nature that I want to drag out in this, right? So they're all in dialogue with one another. So it's perfectly thinkable that we should get all the way to Nietzsche and you want to say something about Socrates. Oh, I never thought about Socrates this way. Turns out I have to change my mind, et cetera, et cetera. They're all open right until the end, right? So that's the discussion forums. If you have questions, send me an email. Maybe I can expand on that. Section tests, right? Course is divided into three sections consisting of two theorists each, Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Hobbes, Kierkegaard, Nietzsche, right? Each of the quizzes for this course will test the section we're working on only. So, Socrates, Plato, done. Won't ask you questions about Socrates and Plato anymore. Right? Aristotle, Hobbes, done. Never bump into Aristotle and Hobbes unless you choose to do so for your final writing assignment, etc., etc. Right? You get the idea. Right? Each quiz will consist of questions totaling to 20 possible points, typically five short answer questions for 2 points each, and then a longer answer question, maybe worth 10. I haven't really decided yet, right? But nonetheless, the shorter answer questions will be very straightforward, asking you to define a term or make an important distinction, a typo there, not of, or make an important distinction. Questions will be designed to test both reading comprehension and a more general understanding of the ideas that we've studied. All of the readings, all of the video material, all fair game for these quizzes. These quizzes will be posted to Moodle at the end of each section, covered by the quiz, indicated in the dates that we're getting to in a section. You'll have at least 5 days with these tests, right? Your responses should be submitted through Moodle, and no late assignments, unless we have a big conversation about how you're going to submit your assignment late because you contacted me well in advance or within 12 hours and have a good reason for it, right? So those are the section tests. I'll record another video that'll go over each of the section tests, just to give you an understanding of what I'm looking for, right? So, final writing project. This will be a 1,000 to 1,250 word reflection paper directed towards your choice between three course overview questions. I'll be formulating these throughout the semester. I've got a couple of stock ones that I'm stifling a sneeze here. I've got a couple of stock questions that I sometimes use, but if something through the forums or through our course discussion seems more interesting than that, then that's what we'll do instead. I'm not asking for the Earth, the Sun, and the Moon with 1,000 to 1,250 words. Before you ask, I don't care, double space, single space, it doesn't matter to me. Reference style, I should have mentioned this on plagiarism, I don't care, APA, MLA, Chicago, I like Chicago, it's what I use, but it doesn't matter, pick one, be consistent. I'm more concerned that you reference than how you reference. I'll formulate these questions, and at the midpoint of the semester by reading week get these up so that you can start thinking about your final writing assignment. So basically the idea is to pick two theorists in one of those questions and engage with that one question using two of the theorists. It's not due until the end of the semester, April 25th. And at that point, really, I can't submit late assignments because I got to get my grades submitted to the office of the registrar and they roll. Right. So, then the project proposal forum, the idea here is that you, offer a substantial argument plan for your project, and not one or two sentence topic presentations. Like for example, substandard ones that I've seen, I'm going to answer question two using Aristotle and Hobbes. The end. No, right? The writing project proposal has to be a substantial sort of argument plan, right? I'm going to answer question two. It pertains to, let's say, the relationship between reason and desire, right? And I'm going to use Aristotle and Hobbes. Well, Aristotle argues this, Hobbes argues this, and I think the tension between these two will provide a well-rounded discussion of the theme. My position is this, and it tends to lead more towards Aristotle than Hobbes, or more Hobbes than Aristotle, or neither of them are wrong, and here's my position. Here's why I think they both miss the mark, right? These are all fine ways to respond to the writing project. I'm, again, not asking for the Earth, the Sun, and the Moon. I grade these pass fail, and it's worth 5%, right? Okay, so instructional technology to be used in this course. I record videos to YouTube, and you access them through Moodle. And you answer forms through Moodle. You submit assignments through Moodle. Moodle is the answer. Right, so figure out how to use Moodle. I've done something new here. All of your important dates are in a bigger font. And your course schedule is all on one page. I might just print this page, like, frankly, if you like take this out and just keep it on your desk, you know what's coming and you don't miss due dates, right? The other thing that I do is I get one of these printable calendars, right? And I put all of my dates on it. So that way I don't miss posting a test for you or something along those lines. So, section tests. First one you've got to worry about is February 8th. Test 2 is due March 14th. Test 3 is, it says quiz, but I mean test, April 8th, right? Which is pretty well as late as I can do a test legally, Right. So, nonetheless, I've complied with official policy, right, with that. The topics, topics proposal forum and submission portal for the final writing assignment for this course will be posted midway through the semester. So you'll get everything for your writing assignment probably by reading week. In fact, here I'm telling you it's going to be up by the start of reading week so that you can start thinking about it then. Sorry, winter recess. Right. The writing project proposal forum will close Monday, April 18th at 10 p.m. That's the last moment Oakland University classes are going on. Final writing assignments due April 25th, 11:55 p.m., 5 minutes to midnight. And the discussion forums close at that point, too. And I tried to give you as clear a schedule week one, week two and three, weeks four and five. Then a test. I laid everything out very, very clear for you. It tells you what to read. It tells you what will be posted to Moodle in terms of videos to screen. I think I give you plenty of time with all of this. I haven't required a ton of reading for any of these sections. The time-consuming things will be these YouTube videos, but even them, they're not that bad. So everything is laid out on one convenient page for you. So if you have any questions, send me an email. And then, finally, get ready for applause. The grading scheme. Right. Now, take a look at my letter grade to percentage point conversion. It's a little different than what you might be used to. The A range starts at 80% with an A minus and goes all the way up to an A plus at 100%. That's the A range. B range is within the 70s, 79.9 down to 70. C's are 60s, D's are 50s. Anything below a 50 is a fail. Just what I think percentage point wise when I say to myself A, B, C, right? So that's just, this is what I grew up with, right? Now, let me show you how it doesn't. I tabulate all of your grades in terms of the percentage points. I convert them by this chart to a letter grade, and then at the end of the course, what you see is a letter grade to grade point conversion from Oakland University Office of the Registrar. All the Office of the Registrar ever sees from me is the 4-point grade. So if you wind up with, let's say, a 77%, 77% is a B plus, and a B plus is a 3.5. The Office of the Registrar sees a 3.5 from me. A B is still a B, an A is still an A, a C is still a C. It's just, the numbers are an arbitrary sort of sign convention, right, for these letter grades. Excuse me. So that's the course. I hope we're going to have fun this semester. You can see from your course schedule that this week we're going to go over the syllabus. Well, we've just gone over the syllabus. Course policy, well, we've just gone over that. Overview and general historical introduction to philosophy and the pre-Socratics what philosophy is for videos will be posted to Moodle as well. That's what we're looking at this week. Next week, we will turn to Socrates with Plato's Five Dialogues, the Apology and the Crito. You'll have video content and supplements for that as well. Let me know if there's anything I can do for you, and we'll talk to you for the next 4 months or so. All right. Have good days, one for each of you.